You know?
I'm moving a lot in this chair right now, though.
Why? Yeah.
It's a swivel.
It's that nervous sexual energy. I get it.
Oh, gosh.
She loves me.
Can't believe we're so close in age now. It's so weird.
We stay the same age. So there's something I want to talk about that I saw. There was this whole thing about people who hire people, and then they look at their Instagram and social media, you know, and then they judge them by that. And sometimes they'll fire them or something. And the people who get fired or whatever, obviously, are like, that's ridiculous. You can't do that. I don't understand what the big deal is. Like, if you hire somebody to do something and then you find they're insane on Instagram or they're drinking or partying or doing whatever, and you're like, hey, I don't feel like this is, shouldn't people be able
to
do that?
It's part of like your public image now.
Yeah, there was a recent thing where a writer for a TV show was fired because he had like some sort of picture with him holding up a gun, saying something that was like almost anti-Black Lives Matter because it was during the rioting and all that stuff. And he was like, don't you come over here. I'll show you guys. One of those things. And he ended up getting fired off the show that he was writing on.
But I mean, like, there was a girl who worked at like a hair salon and they fired her because she was like doing beer bongs or whatever, and they're like, they let you go. And I feel like it should be the, because with dating, right? Isn't that the first thing people do when they're dating somebody?
Sure.
They meet them, and
I
then
guess
they go
now,
and look.
I guess, I don't know.
Yeah, and then you go and look at their Instagram, and you're like, oh, this person's fucking nuts. I'm not calling them back.
For that purpose, I would totally judge them. Like if I was looking to date them, or like if somebody's new friend, or somebody's my friend's new girlfriend, new boyfriend, I would go to their Instagram page and like check out what they're, It's a projection of like who you are a little bit.
It's the quickest way to figure out what a person's about without having to ask them. I mean, you have a whole page populated with your interests and what you're into and how you speak and talk. And like, yeah, I think all that stuff is an extension of yourself and it's fair game.
Mm-hmm.
So why do you think guys still look at like, because when I had Instagram, I would spend so much time looking at chicks. You know, that's the whole thing. It's like, oh, somebody said to you, like, yeah, somebody would be like, look at this chick. And then you get caught up and you're just like spend an hour looking at chicks. But I realized, why did I do that when there was porn? Like, why would I look at girls at dinner with their friends at pictures like of that for hours when I could go on any porn site and see? What do you think it is about guys that they'll do that?
Well, maybe you don't want to look at porn all the time because they're not, you know, it's not like looking at a chick in her natural habitat. Well, I mean, they are in their natural habitat, I suppose. But, you know, you don't get their personalities from watching porn.
Yeah.
There's a difference.
And it's
big
accessible.
Difference.
You could see yourself possibly with that girl. You can have a more fantasy about that than a girl you see in a porno, probably.
Unless you really just dig porn stars.
Well, no, I'm such a germaphobe that I could never. So it's
you can
just,
never be the porn star.
Sometimes I watch things on porn, and then I'm done jerking off, and I come back from like throwing the tissues away or whatever, and I'm like, oh my
podcast.
Yeah,
I love it here.
And I like throw away the fucking tissues or whatever, and then when I come back, I look at the porn I was watching, and I was like, ugh, like, yeah, I just, you know, because I see like. The girl, you know, like just because sometimes
you like snap out of it.
Yeah, I snap out of it. But also you always go to watch porn with a plan. Right. So I'm like, OK, I'm going to look for like this or like a girl pop in my head or like I want to see an ass right now. Or I want to see yoga pants or this. And the same thing always happens. I type in you porn and whatever the first thing I see is I'm like, oh, who's that? You know, and then you're watching like I was watching some like unattractive girl with tattoos, like blowings. And I come back and I'm like, why? What, like, there's so
that
much.
That was me.
Yeah. But it's just.
I'm a little more discerning when I, first of all, go to X Videos or X Hamster. I won't go
okay,
to YouPorn.
Don't judge.
That's a little too, like, mainstream.
X Video, X Hamster?
X Hamster, yeah.
Drea likes this podcast because we don't judge. So
hold
why
on.
Are you judging?
X Hamster.
What I'll do is I'll hit the
Things
I'll
are
hit
about
the
to get
home
fucking
page.
Crazy in here.
I'll hit the home page, but I won't scour the home page. I'll go to Best Videos. Of sort by of the day, of the week, of the month. Then, you know, I'm letting the audience kind of filter out what the best videos are for me, all the viewers, so I can kind of do, somebody's already done the homework or what the best viewers are. So I'll go there. And then if not, if I don't find anything on that page, I will categorize by redheads, busty.
Game of Thrones theme.
Oh, no, they have a Stranger Things theme.
I love redheads. I like the color of the skin, that pale. Mm-hmm. And the pinkness of their areolas.
Oh.
See, he's always going to make it uncomfortable. There's always like a weird, he always does it like doctor-y, where like you feel like you're in the
too
doctor's
clinical?
Room. Yeah, you make even me. I know Jamie gets uncomfortable sometimes. Sometimes no. Even I get.
Do I make you uncomfortable?
You don't make me uncomfortable.
That's right. Okay. Then go on. Then go on.
Dye your hair red, Jamie.
No, it doesn't work for me.
Yeah, if you didn't get a tan, if you weren't so tan.
I'm way too tan for Kasim.
Yeah, yeah. Too dark. Too dark.
Well, there's a new craze now of porn where you don't see the face.
According to who? What are you talking about? Mannequin stuff?
It's always... No. It's a girl. Faces. You just see her body because she wants to remain like anonymous, or she just has a bad
face. Or she's fucking...
What are you doing on your phone?
I'm looking at a ex-hamster.
Oh, yeah.
This brought it horny.
Jerkmate is free in Stranger Things logo.
Yeah, the amount of advertising on those porn sites, it's staggering.
It's thoughtful.
But who jerks off to a porn where you can't
fuck
see the girl's face?
Fuck mom's big boobs. Fuck mom's big boobs.
What the heck?
There's a lot of mommy stuff.
Is there?
Oh, my God.
Dude, the brother, sister.
Yes.
Mommy, son, stepmom
what?
Stuff.
Those are all the number one videos.
This is terrible.
Yeah. It is.
Wife
it's always step,
all
though.
Over.
It's always stepmom, sister,
I'm not buying it, no.
I think my boyfriend told me that he was looking at mom porn. I was like, that makes total sense.
We all got we all have that issue. Yeah.
You don't get enough of it right here?
Oh, it's young boys now, I guess. This must be my thing now.
That I don't understand how I'm a big face guy. Like, if you're watching a porn where you don't see the girl's face, that seems crazy. And it's huge craze. It's not as big as the incest. Incest is like number one right now.
What?
Brother, sister, stepbrother, and it's like, oh, if mommy comes home, she's gonna, and it's always like, it's the worst fucking acting in the world.
I'm like nauseous.
Yeah, it's so
cringy. But wait, the
cringy.
Sexiest incest thing that ever happened was
no,
Hotel New Hampshire. The book Hotel New Hampshire.
What is that?
The John Irving book. And then they also did a movie, and it was Rob Lowe and Jodie Foster playing brother and sister, and they have this crazy affair, and it's one of the best fucking movies ever.
What is it called again?
Hotel New Hampshire.
You want to watch it?
Hotel New Hampshire?
Yeah.
You want to come over and watch it?
It's real sexy. Yeah. I'm not even kidding. Mike and I, my old boyfriend from years ago, remember when I was on The Sopranos, he and I used to walk home from therapy when we were kids and go to Times Square and go. They used to still be open, all the porn booths. And we would go because he was a crazy painter and artist. So it wasn't like we were going there to get off, but they had all the peep show things. It was the coolest fucking vintage thing you've ever seen. But a lot of the movies
probably
you would
smelled
see
good
in there,
too. Yeah.
But it was so cool just visually. But all the movies you would see in there would be this German porn. And these chicks
would be
so gorgeous. They're all like kind of tattooed and dirty and... But like hot, big fucking lips and the blue eyes and like all this like, they were hot. They were hot.
Well, if you go to Amsterdam, the girls in the windows, like those aren't, you could find hot girls in the windows, but they have like some of the most beautiful women in the world are hookers in Amsterdam.
Well, the red light district, yeah.
Yeah, but then they have like, they have the red light district where the girls sit in the window waiting, and then they have the elite, like really beautiful, beautiful women. I couldn't, again, I'm a germaphobe, I couldn't do it, but one of my friends.
Is that the only reason why you don't do it?
Oh yeah, big time. Like oh, but I have fallen into traps, you know. Like
explain
everyone's
the old hooker trap.
Yeah, you know, Jamie, if you had to guess how many
he was dialing like this. Oh, I fell into this fucking trap
in Vegas. Okay,
I lived in Vegas for years. How many hookers do you think I've been with?
Seven.
How many of them were men? By accident.
That's the Amsterdam story, my friend. But what is I'm serious. Remind me. How many hookers do you think I was with the whole time?
How long did you live in Vegas?
2 years. More than 2 years. Probably 3 years.
I don't know what your fuck status is like.
Back then, it was whatever. Let's go.
With drugs? You were on drugs or not on drugs?
Oh, yeah. On drugs, everything.
You're a germaphobe. I'd say zero.
I wasn't as much of a germaphobe when I was drinking. By the way, give me a bottle of tequila right now. No germaphobe.
Did you see his fucking apartment?
Yeah.
Okay.
You would use a tequila to clean off her pussy.
Yeah. So the answer
ow.
Is half of one.
Oh.
So what happened was I was at a strip club.
Wait, a half of one?
One. I don't count it as a full. I was at a strip club and I was like 22 and I'm drinking and I'm fucking partying and I'm having a ball. And this girl, we start talking to a stripper and she starts like rubbing my dick. She's like, she's like, take me back to your hotel and like blah, blah, blah. And I was like, all right. She's like, you're going to take care of me? And I was like, I'm going to fucking take care of you. Like, don't you worry. So I'll never forget exactly what happened. I gave her some weed to roll, and I was going to get in the shower. So I get in the shower, and I'm showering, and all of a sudden, like, from behind me, this hand comes up. We're in the shower together. We go. We have sex, whatever. And, like, right after sex, she was like, okay, so you're going to take care of me now? And I was like, with what? Like, I'll be ready again in, like, 20 minutes. And she was like, no, like, you know, a couple hundred.
Oh, you didn't know she was a hooker?
I had no idea. I was fucking 22. I'm like,
couple hundred. That's a steal.
I'm 22. I'm on Sopranos. Yeah. I'm like, you know, it wasn't odd for me to meet a girl who wanted to fuck. So I wasn't, you know, she's like, and by the way, there had been many times where I was in this particular strip club, met a girl who was like, hey, let's go back to your room, had right. sex, and never, you know, I'd feed her. Because, you know.
Yeah. You're sausage.
Because you're a human.
Yeah. You take care of me. Yeah, I got Dayquil, NyQuil, Theraflu. What do you need? Oh, my
God. Valtrex?
Why don't you lay down here? I'll get a hot towel for your forehead. Valtrex. Oh,
I would order from Cheesecake Factory. I would get the Buffalo Bites. Oh. I was a sweetheart, you know. If she had indigestion, I'd give her some Tums. Whatever, but I wasn't paying. And I remember this girl. And what was really fucked up was, so it was just like this. There were two beds in the hotel. And we had sex on this bed. And I went into this because I knew, I was like, okay, I could either give this girl $200 right now and hope that she gets out of here. Or if I just say, no, I'm not paying you. Like, I don't know, what is there going to be, like, some dude who can't, like, this is going to be such a sticky situation. But I said, if she tries to go over 300, I'm saying no. So I go into the safe. I'm like, bleep, bloop, bloop. I grab $300 bills, but I put two on the edge of, like, the bed or whatever. I get on the other bed and I roll around. I just face the corner. And I was like, please just tell me that she's, I just want to hear the door shut. And she was like, oh, it's like that? Like, or whatever. And I was like, what am I going to say? I just kept looking at the door, looking at the wall. And then I heard, like, the door shut. And I was like, oh, like, it was such a.
Do you think part of her was expecting the pretty woman experience where you were going to go to work that day and she was going to get to go to Rodeo Drive and shop for a new dress?
She was going
to
go to Caesars?
Yeah. The Forum shops?
Yeah.
I mean, I was so sweaty and red. Like, I still get sweaty and red, but when I was drinking, it would be.
Whole body.
Yeah. Like, it just looked like I was dripping.
By the way, I count that as one prostitute. Not a half.
Yeah, what's a half?
That's a full.
Because I didn't sign up for it.
She's still a person.
You still fucked
her. There was sex and then there was money.
I mean, I might have fucked other prostitutes that I didn't pay for. Should it be higher then? Like, if I didn't know the girl was actually
a you're saying, did you have sex with prostitutes, meaning just women that did that?
What if she changed, Jamie? Are people not allowed to change?
Of course
Jamie?
They are, but it's still part of the number.
No, well, what if a girl was a prostitute 5 years before I met her and I slept with her? Am I sleeping with a prostitute?
Okay. No. Okay. No. So I want to say a currently working.
An ex-prostitute.
Yes.
Okay. I wouldn't. The only one I knew was that situation. It was uncomfortable and it sucked. Mm-hmm. But the next night I was back at it. You know?
God bless you.
Yeah. We're right back.
You were at the same strip club.
Yep.
Some chick came up. You going to take care of me?
Yeah.
Like, oh, I'm good. Take care of you.
And then I put the money on the edge of the bed. I was like, I fell for this again.
This went on for 9 months.
Wait, how much did you pay her? How much did you pay her?
I put $200 on the edge of the bed.
That's cheap.
That was cheap.
Inflation. This was fucking.
But she said a couple of hundred. That means
that's
like
two.
Four.
No, it's two.
Yeah, I'd say the going rate right now is $250, $300.
Yeah, we deserve a lot more.
I'm guessing.
We deserve more.
How much
for
are
fucking.
Hookers?
We?
How much are hookers?
I'll be fine now.
I think probably $300
for sexy.
For
sexy
sex? Yeah.
Well, there's the difference. There's the thing of like, hey, I'm coming over until you come. Or there's like the girlfriend experience where it's like, hey, we want to go out to dinner. We want to. I knew strippers, like I became friends with a lot of strippers who would tell me, I know guys who pay me just because they want to talk. Mm. And they weren't lying because they were like, oh no.
I had a lot of friends that were strippers too, and that was true.
Yeah. Really? And it was like the first time it was like sex, and the second, third, fourth, it's like out of the next six times I saw them, we had sex once. Oh. But they just wanted to talk about like, they wanted someone to like, you know, like, oh, like you're so, you're such a good guy. Because, you know, the wife at home was like, my kids' fucking hands are on me all day. You know the deal, Jamie. Yeah. Jamie brought up a great point a couple podcasts ago where she said the reason why she does, or women in general, you could go ahead, Jamie.
Well, I was just saying that I had to explain to Cutter sometimes that, like, especially during quarantine, at the end of a day, I'm touched the fuck out. Like, my kids are all over me. And they're two little boys. And they just need mommy. They're all over my body, everything. And then as soon as they go to bed, Cutter's like, hey.
Yeah.
I'm like, I need a fuck.
I'm like this in bed.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm like, I need a minute. And I feel bad because I'm like, but I don't have a choice. Like, I can't, like, opt out of the kids one day to make right. sure that I'm ready for him. So totally. It's hard.
I agree.
As a guy, never thought about that. I mean, I don't have kids and I'm not married or whatever, but I just never thought of a woman being like, these kids touch me all day. I don't want you touching me now.
You know what else is my problem? I am horniest midday. Mm. Like right now. Like this is my peak.
Mm. Watch out, Cass.
Let's go.
Watch out. Oh.
Time hold for a commercial
what
break.
What a terrible moment real, for an ad.
Real quick, let's take a commercial break. We'll be right back.
So let's talk about how the support we have of this podcast.
Yes. So the guys who make the daily face coverings and the scarves that we've had on the show, Braddock USA, also have a screen print business called Level Press. And they've sponsored this episode. And for those of you who are looking to try and find people that will screen print hoodies, shirts,
bags, water bottles.
Yep. They do a fantastic job. And since we don't have our own merch, we're going to show
gonna
the merch
it.
That
so
they've
Level
done.
So Level Press offers screen printing on all of these things, hoodies, sweatpants, thousands of products. And their services are in-house. So there's no outsourcing, no middleman. Fast turnaround times, mm-hmm. which is huge. They have a full-time in-house designer also to help you with any artwork needs. They service fashion brands, podcasts, content creators, or even if it's just for a party.
Yeah.
And again, all in-house. So, I mean, I think that's, you know, everybody's worried about outsourcing where things are going. So, you know, it's reliable all in one place. Drop shipping is also available. So, if you want to get 15% off your first order, visit levelpressinc.com/InMyPJPants and use code InMyPJPants. You fill out a form at the link, give them a call, place an mm-hmm. order, and you get how much off, Cass?
15% off. And like I said, for those of you that are looking to make shirts, even if it's for like a small party or yeah. if you have a business and you need some merch done, they've done all the merch for Tiger Belly. If we ever do merch, I will strongly consider them. And I recommend you guys support the people that support the podcast. And thanks, Level Press and Braddock USA.
Yeah, again, that's in my PJ pants at levelpressinc.com/inmypjpants.
All right, guys, one of our sponsors is back. It's Manscaped. We're very happy to have them. They have the Lawnmower 3.0, the best tool in hygiene for the modern man.
Do you like shaved balls, Trey?
I would like to watch you shave your balls.
Oh,
see,
wow.
I know it.
Dude, well, there would be an ad.
Yeah, you hear that, Manscaped? You guys got 10 grand because we could talk.
We could throw that up.
Rob
on
does
YouTube,
it over the toilet.
Hub.
We just learned.
I used to before used I started to. Doing it in the shower.
Okay, because yeah. now we have a cordless trimmer, the crop preserver, which is the deodorant, and then mm-hmm. the crop reviver, which is the spray-on toner.
Yeah.
Your balls are going to be in the best shape they've ever
yeah.
been in.
Things that were once just for your face. Are now available for your nuts.
Yeah, Lawnmower 3.0, the perfect package 3.0, comes with everything you need. You go to manscaped.com, promo code PJPants, you get 20% off and free shipping.
Yep, again, that's manscaped.com and use code PJPants. Your next person you see naked will thank you.
Thank you.
Wow.
Oh,
Jamie,
man.
You were saying?
it's very difficult because, like, you know, right before I left for here, Cutter was like walking to my car and like his sweats and like, you know, when you could see like the outline of like their package and like sweats
that.
And like his t-shirt. And I'm like, oh, he's so hot. Like, if I could, I would have gone to my bedroom with him like right then and there. Nighttime, I am.
Yeah.
This is the last thing I want to do is have sex at night.
It's true.
I want to get stoned. I want to eat. I want to watch TV. I want to maybe cuddle. Maybe not.
Jamie, I think that you and I should be together at
should
night.
Should we be? I think you and I would make a great couple.
I think
we
you and I should be
together,
in the nighttime.
Wednesday night
great.
Scissors. Yeah.
We'll just depart midday.
Yeah. What, you prefer midday or morning or?
It's not even, I am so psycho in my house with everybody that's there. And at nighttime, and I have a 35-year-old boyfriend who's like, come on, let's yeah. go. Morning, noon, and night. And I'm just like, can I just catch my fucking breath? So it's definitely been a juggle, a ball juggle.
Mm. Everybody who listens to this podcast knows us 35-year-olds love to do the fucking
hell.
Love
amen.
To do sex.
Just ask Big Ed. Big Ed will tell you about me. Can you, for guys who will never know, can you compare a female orgasm to anything else?
Say it again.
Can you compare a female orgasm? Because we'll never understand.
Well, I think we can understand because I've heard that if you had a prostate if your prostate was milked and you had an orgasm at your butt, that's as close to a female orgasm as possible.
Huh? Wait, are we saying that a male orgasm is totally different than a female orgasm?
Oh, absolutely.
Because I never really think about it.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. Women is way more like...
I just assumed it was the same sensation.
Oh, geez.
Women's way more enhanced, you're saying?
Yeah, yeah. I could have an orgasm watching, flipping through a channel. Like, you know, like I could, it could just... there wouldn't be this big, like, they were when a girl really, you know, you could, it's like, holy shit.
I don't know. Every guy I've been with always seems like they're having an orgasm like a girl, I guess.
Their legs tense up and start twitching? No.
No, ours, I think, are shorter and less intense. Women's are longer.
And it could happen, boom, 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 boom.
Yeah, but I did hear, you know, if you get your prostate milked, it's as close. You should...
So that's a finger in the ass.
That. It's a couple fingers not? Up there.
Yeah. Ugh, that's yeah. I just
I don't. I wouldn't know. I did try once.
Yourself?
Not myself. No. No, my doctor. Ron.
Who's the lucky lady?
You know, jeez. I did have to get. Different pod. Yep. Different story.
Yep.
I want to hear.
I know.
This filthy bitch is here.
Go ahead. They want to hear.
Yeah, let's go.
Well, I had. You know. When I was a kid, a doctor put his finger up my butt.
See, here's the deal. Me and Cassim are disgusting. We just wait for Jamie to tell us when we're crossing the line. And right now, she wants to hear more. So okay, here's your opportunity.
I mean, he's just being very vague.
She's fucking horny, bro.
Because now I'm wondering if it was inappropriate that the doctor did that.
Well, we still don't know if it is.
Was this the dentist?
A child is getting a prostate exam.
Is there laughing gas involved?
Okay, so this is...
If you don't want to tell, I actually
no, just gross. He's got
it's
no choice.
It's just gross. It's just gross.
Oh, you had a little issue with your butt when you were a little boy.
I had an issue because I peed too much, and I went to the doctor because I was going to go to outdoor school. Out here, you go to this thing for a week in sixth grade where you go away to camp for a week with your class.
Like and sleepaway camp.
Sleepaway camp. Outdoor is that what you call school? It? We call it outdoor
school. He's vague about that, too.
Outdoor
we call
school.
It outdoor school.
Man, there is some trauma
school.
Here.
It's called outdoor
camp?
School.
Did you do math on the trees?
I was worried that I was going to have to...
he rewired you when he put his finger
math
in your ass.
In the trees. There was a lot of learning, okay? I was worried that I would have to get up to pee in the middle of the night too much because I was going twice in the middle of the night. No. My mom's like, oh, poor kid. We don't want him to make him feel weird. We'll go to the doctor.
Bears.
I asked the doctor, or she asked the doctor, if this is normal. He's like, well, let me do a checkup. He told her to leave. And then
how old were you?
He stuck his finger out.
No, I wouldn't either.
How old were you?
12.
Yeah,
no,
I was in sixth grade. Not 12.
Yeah. Sixth grade is 12.
And then,
yeah,
you know,
that's 12.
He went in there because I had 11. No plans of this happening. And then he put his finger in there. And then when he was done, he was like, not when he was done, while his finger was in there, he said, oh, you got some poopies in there, huh?
Well, was he lying?
No, I had poopies in there. So,
what did you do with your
was
partner?
I molested?
I don't know if you were molested or not, and
was
I'm hysterical
I?
Laughing. It's fucking
was
terrible.
Left and
do you
right.
feel like you were molested? Because
well, when I came
feel,
home,
Cass.
When I came home to go to the bathroom, it felt weird to sit down.
Did you tell your mom?
Yeah, I think I don't know.
She'll hear it now.
I'm very uncomfortable about this whole thing.
When you want us to stop, just let us know. Did you ask? Did you ask? What did you say to your mom after you came out? Or did she say what just happened?
I don't remember. I just assumed the doctors know what they're doing. That's the thing with doctors, you know? That's what this whole U.S.
That's
Olympic gymnastic thing
doctors,
is. We just
police,
trust them.
They all know what they're doing, right?
And they can stick their fingers wherever they want. No one's going to question
I just
it.
Picture, like, little fucking Cass with his feet dangling off the side picking out a lollipop when his mom walked in the room. Like, so is everything. And he's just, oh.
Yeah, I got some poopies in there.
Oh, but did you Google it since? You know, is that a way to check
no.
to see if a little boy is peeing too much?
He said, well, I said, I think my mom's like, is it normal for a kid to pee twice in the middle of the night? He's like, yeah, there is no normal. It's fine. And then that was it. And then I went to outdoor school. I didn't use the fucking bathroom for a week to shit. I just went piss when no one was around.
Because he pushed it up in. He pushed...
I didn't shit for a whole week. Yeah, he shoved.
How do you get shit?
Nobody
for,
wants to shit
choice?
At sleepaway camp. Come
I
on.
Didn't. There was no
too,
doors in where
oh,
the
no,
toilets
fuck
were.
How
there were just
choice?
A.
Fuck
was
that.
A,
just like, how does your body allow you
I
to do
didn't,
that?
I just didn't. I didn't.
Weird.
That's wow, Cass. We got
a.
This
I have
is gonna
a lot
be a long
questions.
Car ride.
If there's any doctors or therapists out there,
Rob's not answering any of the DMs on the way home. No. He's got some talking to do.
Yeah, Castle's got to answer my DMs. I got to know what. Holy
slide
shit.
Slide in like that doctor did. Too soon?
It's okay when it's your own butt.
That's my nightmare for my boys all the time. I think of is like, I constantly am like, just so you know, the only person allowed to touch is you, mommy or daddy in bath time, and Dr. Peter, if I'm there.
And in six more years, Drea. She likes them young.
Terrible. But yeah, it's my biggest fear with the kids too. Right? Always. Oh yeah. And I've definitely had some strange young experiences. So you're not alone. Don't worry.
Thanks.
But I want to bet my money on the fact that he was really checking to see if you had something.
I hope.
Yeah. Okay.
I hope.
All right.
Otherwise, I'm a victim.
You're a survivor, not a victim. That's what they say.
That's right.
What do you want your kids to do when they grow up? Do you have any idea yet?
Me?
Yeah.
Well, Bama's a fucking rad artist.
Her career is carved out for her. She lays in bed and cries at night, and she says, like, I just don't know. I don't have enough time in the day because I want to write this script, but I also want to make sure I'm still working on my piano, but the guitar thing is still calling me. But I love dancing, but I don't know if I'm good at it, but I have to make sure I'm still doing my art. I'm like, and my photography. I'm like, fuck.
It's crazy
me.
How
I get stressed out doing two podcasts in a day.
I was just going to say, it's crazy how often on this podcast people describe what you're supposed to be. And me and Kasim both have the same feeling, which is we're the opposite of that.
Yeah.
You know, like when somebody's like, she's so driven and she wants to.
Yeah, I'm the opposite of that too.
Like, what the hell is that?
She takes after her dad in that way.
Or like when Kasim, Jamie said, what'd she say? Oh, she's like, I look for the great thing in people and I celebrate it. And Kasim's like, yeah, I think I'm the opposite of that. Like, yeah. I think I
want to tear you down.
I look for the worst and I try and fucking, you know?
Yeah. I see everyone's beauty first. Yes. And then they fuck me over and I'm like, I don't know why.
Yes.
Well, as one of those guys, I just want to say thanks for existing and letting us continue to be the assholes that we are. Yeah.
So in that whole talk of that, the gymnast documentary, let's say you wanted your kid to be like, you want Bo to be a golfer. Let's say the best.
No. Cutter wants Bo to
Cutter
be
wants.
A golfer.
Okay.
I want Bo to be whatever the fuck he wants to be.
Right. So let's say Bo wanted to be the golfer. You guys agree. And there's this guy who sees potential in him. He's the best coach, mm-hmm. but he always
licks his lips when he sees Bo.
Yeah, the way that the way that
like when Jamie gets hungry.
The way that
we've discovered that when food is starting to be brought to me at like a restaurant or anywhere, I lick my lips.
Oh, that's okay. But what about this person who licks his lips?
That's why he's saying it.
Oh,
because I do that. I go.
If the way that Bo's guy coming. Got results was by like very stern and being an asshole and really be like no, there's no time for like treating him harshly, would you be all right with that?
That's an interesting question. Because there's some times where Cutter and I will say, like, I think Bo does better when he has somebody that's a little more, like, strict.
Mm. Yeah, Blackjack too.
Like, he just, like, he loves to joke around. That's who he is. And sometimes, like, to get him to focus, you got to be like, hey, yo. Like, uh-uh. Because I'm tough. And he listens to me more than anybody else. So I don't know. I mean, somebody calling him like a piece of shit and stuff? No. Nope. But like,
what age can they start calling him a piece of shit?
Never.
I don't know. 18? If he's being a piece of shit.
Oh, yes. Okay. Yes.
If he's being a piece of shit, he's allowed to be called a piece of shit.
So what do you think? If there was like this amazing artist who saw potential in Bama and just said, hey, I would love to take her under my wing, and she did, but she didn't treat her nicely.
I'm not down with that. You know, just being an actor and taking acting classes with certain teachers, you don't need to be fucking broken down in that way.
You know, Cutter said that to me recently because I was in this acting class that like wasn't making me feel great. And he said to me, he's like, Jamie, there's two types of people I've learned from being in sports. There's the people that thrive from criticism and people pushing you and saying it's not good enough. There's people that thrive from that. And then there's other people that thrive from like love and support and validation. He's like, and that's you. So if you're not getting that, you need to go somewhere else. It doesn't mean that you're not good. You're just not, you're not going to thrive until you get the support you need. And I think everybody's different in how they respond.
So, yeah, some people have to be broken, I think, and some people are broken and need to be loved and taken care of. Mm-hmm. And a lot of sensitive artists like that, like especially Bama, if she was getting broke, but she's so tough. I don't know. she's tough and she's sensitive. She's like all these things. But yeah, nobody needs to be broken over and over again.
Because that was that movie, what was it, like Whiplash?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Right? I love Rich, that movie.
What was that?
The drummer.
J.K. Simmons.
Oh, it was so good.
Right, but that was the thing, right? It was like to make him great.
Yes.
He had to, he felt like that was, whether it was, he felt like it was for him or that was just how he treated.
Well, maybe he could have been great with another teacher, but we don't know. But we don't know.
Right.
But there is a line. There's just a little.
What's the line? Like if Blackjack came home, imagine he's 10 years older maybe or a little older. And what would you accept coming home and him saying, and then where would you be like, nope, I'm going to fucking smack this dude in the face?
My kids come home with a lot of issues from school, from their public schools and stuff, and I let them go for a long time. And Bama will ask to like let me ride this out, and I will want to go in and fucking bust heads. With Blackjack, I convince him to let things ride out for a little bit, so that he can take care of himself a little bit and learn how to fight. And I'll teach him how to fight. But to fight peacefully as much as he can until he can't fight peacefully anymore. And then I make a phone call to the school and I say, my kid now has my permission to punch that kid in the face. If no one else is holding him back and there aren't discussions and peace talks and all the things that we try first.
Right.
But once, you know, his little life's threatened on the playground, he's now allowed to act like a total raging lunatic if he needs to.
Yes.
You know.
I think it's good advice.
I try really hard. We try every avenue first, you know, nonstop talking. We talk for hours about what the right thing to do is and like fleshing it out, you know. It's hard. But then I finally went in and dealt with Bama's teacher. And I started crying in the room with the teacher.
Really?
Yeah, I was like, you're picking on the wrong kid. I understand you want to make an example out of one of these children in this classroom, but this isn't the one. This is the good one. This is the one who doesn't make mistakes, who's afraid, who wants to please you. This is not the kid that's getting hickeys in the back of the fucking school and smoking cigarettes. I said, so fucking pick on somebody else. But they took her because she was the weakest. And I was like, you took a weak child, not the weakest, but the most sensitive.
Right.
I was like, you took the shyest child in the class. You're like a fucking
bully.
Yeah, I was like, you're bullying her. And I started crying. I made Shooter go with me. I normally deal with all this shit by myself. I was like, you need to come with me in case I go this way or that way. I'm either going to be crying or I'm going to fucking rip her head off. And of course, I was like, are you picking on the wrong kid?
That was your Oscar moment, right?
Oh, they missed. You're such a good mom.
She ended up really fucking, she was blown away, the teacher. And she was like, that's it. I'll never pick on her again. And every day Bama came home and said, I really like her now.
Oh. Wow.
But the teacher was strict and she was a good, strict teacher. But eventually I had to step in. And then it, you know, I think she didn't do it to anybody in the class after that.
Yeah.
We try and hit all emotions on this podcast.
Yeah, you know, we've really covered it all.
To lay down on this table right now. JJ, can we snuggle?
So you're like a music chick, right? You love music. Do you ever feel like...
Go ahead, say it. Am I a groupie? Go ahead.
No. I was just saying, have you ever played an instrument? I wanted to know. Or are you good at anything musically, or do you just love it?
I am really not good at anything, not even acting. I mean, I'm a good mom.
True.
I'm a good mom. Sometimes I don't even think I am a good mom. We're just always learning. I feel like I'm learning. I say to the kids.
Well, then that's good, right? If you're learning, then you're fucking amazing at it. Because the bad moms are probably the ones who are like, I got this when they're fucking 3 years old.
Yeah, no, you have an awareness and you're just always trying to be better.
Yeah, I always, because when the kids get in trouble and they're like, I'm a bad person, I'm like, no. I'm like, dude, you're learning and I'm learning. I was like, do you think I know what it's like to have a 9-year-old child? This is the first day that I'm dealing with a 9-year-old child who has this problem in my life.
Right.
So I don't know what the fuck I'm doing, but I'm going to do the best I can. But that's my favorite instrument to play, the babies. But I did learn how to play instruments when I was young. I wasn't very good at it. And yeah.
We clearly know you like to play the sympathy card because this whole thing you've been doing. But what instruments do you play?
I played the guitar a little bit when I was little, but little. In my 20s. I was little in my 20s.
So we all were.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I think it was when we were doing The Sopranos, probably. I was taking lessons.
Oh, cool.
Maybe.
What is it about musicians that you're attracted to?
You know something? I don't really know that it's musicians. I'm a music freak.
Mm.
I love music so much. For me, it's like this great common denominator where we can all have all these differences, believe in different things, but yet you put everybody in this one room together and they hear this one song and all of a sudden everyone's on the same page for 3 minutes in your lifetime. And I feel like that kind of magic just sort of transcends anything in my life.
The universal language, for sure.
Yeah, it makes me crazy. And when I hear like a voice, like she can sing, like, oh my God, to hear someone's voice.
Yeah.
It's like from the angels to me. It's got a whole different, it takes on a whole different, it's not just music. It's,
yeah.
It is cool. It's whenever I revisit singing again, it is so cool that your body is your instrument.
Oh my
and like
God.
When you're in it, in your stride and like it's feeling effortless, it's completely transcendent. You're like, something else is doing
yes,
this.
You
right
feel
now.
That as, for a, sure. as a singer. Oh, I would never know what that feels like, but I love to watch it. And I guess
it
that's
makes
how...
you feel that way when you watch it.
Yeah.
I feel that way when I watch people sing and also when I watch people dance.
Yes.
Like amazing.
Oh my
like
God.
I'm
beautiful
just like,
dancers,
I can
beautiful
feel
dance performance.
The expression. Yeah.
Me too. Yeah. I used to love to dance. That was my thing when I was young. Don't laugh at me, fucking Ginger. I will kill you. I used to like to dance like this. You know, no. I took like, you know, the classical dance.
Yeah. Oh,
you dance on a box in a club.
At the club.
Hey, that's a type of dance.
No. I was jazz and tap were my favorite.
Amazing.
Anyways.
You're the type of dancer who would then charge someone $200 to have sex with
you? That's me, baby.
I'll never forget her for that.
But yeah, so the musicians for me, when I guess they speak a language that is so foreign to me, yet it's the most familiar. Mm. And I'm mesmerized by it. I don't even understand what they do. So yeah, I've been through every band member, I guess, up until now that I'm almost 50. The singer, the guitar player, the bass player, the piano. Now I'm onto the drums, babe.
Yeah.
Nice.
I got to start playing the guitar that's also the keyboard. What is that?
You haven't the fucked with that, right?
I'm going to start playing the guitar.
Yes!
Because you're gonna get that low at one point.
Yeah.
He's going to be doing that one-man band. He's going to have the whole thing.
Yeah.
A harmonica.
I'm going to have a cymbal on my shoulder.
Yeah. Yeah. And I'll be with my walker.
Yeah. Rob!
Remember me?
Rob, stop!
Jamie, if Sopranos never happened and you were going to audition for American Idol, what would be your song?
I would never have, but what would have been my song?
Yeah. What's your slam dunk, like, I know I could fucking knock the
it's
socks off
like
of these
Broadway
people?
It's all like Broadway shit. That's why. Mm.
Which one? I'll know what it is.
What?
What if you pick a Broadway one?
Like, when I was younger, it would have been, like, On My Own from Les Mis.
Mm-hmm. I know that.
Yeah. Oh, you do?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Pretending
like that.
You're beside me.
There you go. Yeah.
I was less familiar with Les Mis. I can't believe you know.
Oh, that's like the best.
I was less familiar with
Between
that.
The
I was
porn
more into the
that,
real dancey ones.
Oh, really? Like Rodgers and Hammerstein or something?
Chorus Line. I saw maybe 12 times when I was little.
Have you seen Every Little Step?
No.
You got to watch it tonight. Have you seen it? Every Little Step is a documentary about the audition process for the revival that
this.
They did. And it's like you're watching the real Chorus Line of them auditioning for Chorus Line. Like these people's real stories, this woman feeling like she's too old, like them making it past the next point.
Oh, it's so good. I got to check it out.
Is it on Netflix?
Probably. I saw it in a theater like 10 years ago, but it's so good. It's so,
I
gotta so
check
good.
It out.
You got to text that
it.
To me. I want to see. I love.
You do?
Oh,
you.
Well, I just love. I love watching people audition for stuff like that. Even when.
And these are like the real Broadway chorus dancer singers that have been
from
fucking,
a Chorus Line.
They're auditioning for the revival of a Chorus Line.
But I get to see them
like
stressing
you're watching
out.
The real what the show's about.
Wow.
I want to see them stressing
show.
Out. Do I get
yes,
to see that? Yeah,
they
okay,
completely
that's what I want.
Stress out. Then this woman breaks down, and then you're pulling for her to fucking kill it in the audition. Like, oh.
Wow.
I watched Fossey Vernon, that show.
I haven't seen it yet.
I want to see it.
Oh, Sam Rockwell's and I think Michelle Williams.
Yeah. They both won
so good.
Awards,
yeah,
as she
yeah, yeah.
did, right?
And it's about stuff I have no sort of like knowledge
that
about.
Time,
have you ever
yeah.
seen All That Jazz, though?
No.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
If you've seen. No? Have you? Oh my God. Jen, have you?
If Rob would have said yes, Sarah would have killed
it
myself.
It is one. It's not easy to find on the internet anymore. I have it on VHS, of course. Did I just spit everywhere? It's one of the best movies of all time. It's Roy Scheider, right? Is that how you say it? Roy Scheider?
From Jaws?
He plays Bob Fosse.
Oh, really?
He is fucking insane. Jessica Lange plays
his
dream, like his imagination. Right, and Ryan King plays his girlfriend. It's out of control.
All right, I'll
it's
watch
so
it.
Good. It's weird. It's dark. It's
yeah. I'd love to see it. It's based on his life and kind
yes.
of yeah. Oh, great!
It's fantastic. It's one of my favorite movies of all time.
You know what I would do if I was gonna sing? It'd be that Sinead O'Connor song.
Oh, nothing compares.
Nothing compares.
To you.
Yeah, I think that's one of the greatest music videos.
That's Prince
of all time.
Yep. Yeah, it is a Prince song.
Do you know what music video I loved so much?
And Chris Cornell did it better than both of them, by the way.
Do I remember that?
Chris Cornell fucking killed
Chris Cornell
that song.
Does most things, or did most things better than
Oh my God. When he did that song.
When her tear drops and that sort of. Ugh.
What about Everything, Everybody Hurts, the REM? I loved that music
That's
video.
Good.
I was so emo at that time. I was like, yeah.
Yeah, it's true. Everyone
so I
does
the back
hurt.
Of the car we in traffic do. Of my parents'
You're
car.
Like, ow.
Yeah.
Yeah, that one didn't get me. I was an old REM fan. Old.
Hmm. So let's say if it's not singing, let's say if let's say aliens came down and they wanted
now
to
we're
know,
talking.
And they wanted to know what music was, and but you could play them one song. What song would you play for them?
One song.
Yeah,
I'd start with some Michael Jackson. I'd say this guy's a little complicated, but
do you know what I think? I think because I have so many favorite music bands, but of course I like rock and roll.
Yeah,
I feel like maybe Zeppelin would encapsulate. Because they ripped off the blues so much, but then they also get really dark, and then they also have strange lyrics. I feel like that might bring together, and they have that epic vibe. Because, you know, I love like Sabbath and the Stones and all these other bands, but Zeppelin kind of has every. Mm-hmm.
Would you play Thank You?
I love Thank You.
So good.
I love Thank You. Or even like Tangerine, the slower
Tangerine,
ones.
So good.
You don't want to play
10 Years Gone.
That was the Years Gone. I would play them 10 Years Gone. Yeah. That would be the one.
That's your alien
That would
song.
Be the one because that one has everything and it's long and it's epic, you know?
That's a new thing. So, what's your alien song? That's the
10 Years
what's,
Gone.
You got one?
I need to think. Okay. No, I don't have one off. What's yours?
Cass? I don't know. I think I would judge it on how the aliens looked.
True.
Like if they were like
what if
the
they were
little
the The lion people. Do you know what the lion people?
This guy knows everything
about. The lion
about.
People.
Oh,
yes,
man.
I think they're called the Pashat or the Pashat? Pashat?
That's the name of the chocolate bar Jamie gave me.
Please tell me
more.
That's right.
No, I don't know.
They're these giant feline beings, and they're, I don't know which dimension that they predominantly inhabit, but supposedly they would never show themselves to a human being. Mm. Sekhmet, she's the goddess of all of the cat people, but they're lion faces, but they're about
is that an Egyptian
tall.
God?
I she wonder if they look like how they looked in the movie Cats.
Like the rum tum tum.
That's why it just didn't. Kind it just like didn't translate here.
Did you actually watch it?
No.
Oh, me neither. I'm waiting for the butthole
cut. Cats is my first. What was the thing that got me to want to act?
Really?
No.
What was?
When I was little, my mom brought me to the opening of Cats, and the rum tum tugger took me on stage. I was in the second row. Took me on stage and just did his whole the rum tum tugger is a curious cat or serious cat or whatever the fuck he says. And I was standing there in my striped Norma Kamali outfit when I was
so
a little
chic.
And I was like this. I'll never forget. And that was it. I was like, I'm petrified and I love this and I never want to get off this fucking stage.
Oh my God.
The power of Broadway. It worked.
Yeah. It was music. It was the power of music and dance.
Power of music.
And the eyes on you.
and the cat.
Yes,
cat.
Fucking
I was like,
cat.
Cat.
Wow. It's so funny because I heard Steve Sharippa talk about when he did, like some show he did. Not was it Damn Yankees or something? And he was like, I was terrified
on Broadway. Was he doing a show on?
I think
on
he
stage?
Did like a one-time showing of it for some charity thing or something. But would you be terrified when you would do Broadway stuff?
No, I fucking loved it.
That's right. You were doing all those plays back then.
I
went
it.
With you to one. I remember you were. I don't know why I went with you. You asked me and someone else. Were you with us? Who? We got in a limo with you. And
everyone at home was like, me?
I think I had to introduce you or something.
Oh, yeah. It was like a Broadway benefit on like Bravo or something where all different people were singing Broadway songs. And you did. You introduced me. It was at like some
the Felt Forum or something.
Yes,
what the equivalent to the Felt Forum was. I'm showing my age right now because the Felt Forum definitely doesn't exist. Do you remember the old Madison Square Garden?
Yeah, yeah. No, it was somewhere else. But yes, I do remember that.
It was that part of the garden, wasn't it? That other theater
in the garden. In the
theater
part? Was that where it was?
I think so.
I remember it was like in the round.
That's
not
the theater.
But I do remember. No, that's not the theater in the garden.
I don't remember.
But yes, yes, I do remember that.
Would you ever go back on stage?
Yeah, I think because of MS, like I just don't know how I could or
what about
would.
Drama though, not any kind
a
of
play?
Like massively physical. Because I won't do it until the kids are grown. I have a dream that once the kids are grown, I can move back to New York.
Yeah.
And then I just see myself sitting in my dressing room with my face totally taped back with like a cigarette hanging out of my mouth and my hair like in a beanie.
Yes.
Put my wig on and them coming and saying, Ms. DiMatteo, we're ready for you.
Yeah. Yes, it's going to happen.
And I'm doing
chills.
Like some Noel Coward play.
Yes. Fuck yeah.
One day.
Yeah, no, I would love to do like stage to me. I'm feel the most more comfortable than in front of a camera.
Really? Mm-hmm. I felt that way at first. And then once you start doing that TV thing, that grind, nothing else seems to work after that. Not even movies for me.
Sometimes I have to be reminded that I still like it. You know, when you tend to have time away from it for a while. But I was telling them, I'm now in the middle of the third season.
She's rewatching Sopranos.
Mm-hmm. For the first time.
Oh, right. That's so
crazy. Oh, yeah, she's watching Sopranos.
And it's so good.
Will you come on the show once you've watched the whole thing?
Well, I just,
will you come and talk about it?
Yes. Okay. I can't believe that I was on the show. Like, it's so fucking good. Yeah. And I knew everyone was good on it, but now I'm watching it and I'm like,
it's crazy.
Oh my God.
Oh, stop.
No. Are you watching it?
No. Everyone. Like,
you
everyone.
Need to.
He doesn't. We can't get him to even come close.
I have a lot of things in my life like this where like everybody wants me to do this thing and I'm like, I don't.
All right, fuck you, don't do it.
Thanks. See, I need someone like you.
Drea, where in your rewatch podcast, where are you in the show?
We just finished the first season, okay. But we're hitting pause for a minute because I have all this other stuff going on. Plus, I'm supposed to go back east to see my mom. Plus, we're not sure if we're switching gears right now.
Right.
We're in the middle of that at the moment.
Yeah, okay.
We're going to continue with the rewatch and we'll continue with season two. We're just not sure if it'll be the same name or what our situation will be. We'll know in a little bit.
Yeah, you guys are great together, you and Chris Kushner.
Yeah.
Yes. Made Women. If you guys haven't seen it or listened to it, I'm sure you have, but it's Made Women.
Yes.
And youtube.com/Made Women.
Thanks, guys.
Mm-hmm. I think it needs to be a lot more about you and her and less about Sopranos, but that's just me.
Well, if we switch gears, which is a possibility, we'll continue with the Soprano rewatch because people really do dig it. Yes.
Oh, for sure, yeah.
Because we don't really talk about the show as much as we talk about how we relate to all of these crazy topics on the show.
Right.
More interesting to me.
It is so
interesting. There are so many different things that go detailed, episodic, sort of like this is what happened in the episode, and anyone can do that. You know what I mean?
But it's like why it really resonated.
Cass, what's your alien song? You have a song for the aliens?
I don't know. It'd probably be one of those ones I grew up with, like 588-2300 Empire.
Wow.
They had that out 588. Here too.
Huh? They had that out here too. I thought that was a New York thing.
Oh no, I think it's an all over thing, man.
Wow.
Those guys at Empire. Yeah, yeah.
They might be aliens. That might be their song.
Yeah.
I think Larry H. Parker is definitely an alien.
See, I think you're doing like if it's what was that movie that just came out when the UFOs came? That was like 3, 4, or 5 years ago.
Arrival? Or with
I liked that one.
Oh, it was great.
I think it was Arrival. Yeah, like
with Amy Adams.
Yeah,
they talk through like a wall thing.
Right. Yeah, those aliens are getting a different song than like the little gray aliens.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I mean? Because though, like, for some reason right now,
what are the little gray ones getting?
Like some like party all the time. You know, like some little
party song.
Yeah, like because they're little like
some club hits.
You know? Yeah. And I think not this, but it's just in my head, like U2, With or Without You. Like some, but it depends if they know our language too, right? Because you got to know the words to With or Without You. Otherwise, you're just kind of hearing.
That would be your alien song?
It'd be one of them. Because now that song has so many like corny
times. I would play the movie soundtracks.
Play the movie soundtrack.
Movie sound, like some Hans
Close
Zimmer
Encounters.
Shit, you know what I mean?
Give a little, like, hey, hey,
no, just
hey,
like,
hey.
I think movie soundtracks make you feel emotions without words. So I think that if they hear like movie soundtracks, they can feel like, oh, this is all the things humans feel.
Like Secret Garden from Jerry Maguire.
They feel excitement. They feel sadness. They feel...
I don't like when movies are scored to death, though. Do you?
No, I don't like when they're scored to death, but...
You notice The Sopranos is not scored, right?
At all.
I know. There's moments, and you're like, wait. This,
yes. But
then it fell apart. Then they abandoned it.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
There was... Bruce Springsteen did that Secret Garden for Jerry Maguire, and then they would play it on Z100 with the clips from the movie.
That was so annoying.
Oh, so good.
I don't remember.
She's like, I love him, Laurel. I want to be, smell him, and whatever she says.
You
I don't know.
Me at hello.
Yeah.
Oh, you like all that stuff. It's cute.
Oh, I love that. So well, before my heart got broken.
Loves a good romp.
Before my heart got broken all the time. Robbie. Now I just like to sit in my apartment alone and do nothing.
Well, you know what a good alien song is? Memory of a Free Festival by David Bowie. And it's talking about the sun machine coming down and they're going to have a party. And he talks about Venusians.
What?
I never heard that.
The alien race.
Is that alien language?
The Venusians.
Yeah,
yes.
I've heard of those. Yeah.
They're from Venus. They're all about love.
I think,
Jamie.
I've been listening to a lot of Kacey Musgraves lately. And she for sure is into like the psychedelic shit. And I feel like
her. I don't know her music. I'll check it out.
Oh, yeah. I feel like Cutter and I the other day were like, she's definitely had taken a lot of mushrooms to write this song.
Nice. There's a song Already Gone by Sleeping At Last that would fucking, that'll get you.
Yeah.
I don't know that band.
Well, it's a very, I don't know if you'd like it. It's very soft and like slow.
He loves soft, slow, melodic music.
I do. I like very so sad. Emo. Listen, my neighbors must
you would never
fucking
think that.
Hate me because when
it?
I find a song, I just play it over and over.
I'm going to send you a song.
Yeah. I mean, over there. What was that?
I got
that,
a song for you.
What was that song Louis Capaldi just had? You know that one? Someone You Loved or Used to Be in Someone You Loved. That song. I played that 500 times when it came out. And I was like, this is one of the fucking greatest songs I've ever heard. I still think it's a real, it's up there. It's a really incredible song.
Yeah, you did that with a Billie Eilish song.
No. I just said this is
one.
A good song. I didn't listen to it over and over.
You Rob, do like.
Cute.
Yeah.
No, you're getting a little, he's very,
little turned on.
Yeah, he's got that side of him that he doesn't like to show, but he gives you a little glimpse into every once in a while.
My boyfriend listens to all the sad music too.
Yeah.
I love sad music.
Yeah, he likes
and
all
what's,
sad
what's,
music.
What's his name again?
Robbie.
Yeah, and how old is he?
35.
Wow.
Guys, if you don't know how old I am, I'm 35.
And he's Robbie.
I mean, come on. It's not a little weird, Jamie, that she did that?
I mean, I don't know how intentional it was.
It was totally calculated.
I know. Do you remember, so you FaceTimed me a couple of weeks ago. Do you remember the first thing you did when you FaceTimed me?
Me?
Yeah.
Oh, recently when I FaceTimed you. Oh, we called you to gossip.
Yeah, but do you remember the first thing you did when you FaceTimed me when I picked up?
Did I have the phone in my panties?
No. Ginger, do you remember what she did?
Over shirt.
She took her shirt off.
Yeah.
That's right. She's like, there he is. And she just takes her shirt off. Boom.
That's not what happened.
That's exactly what happened. Because it is.
I remember.
Ginger, see? Because I had my shirt off. So you were like, oh, yeah. And you took your shirt off.
Maybe I wanted to know if I could manscape my chest with your manscape tool.
Ugh, you definitely need it in those pits. Okay, we want to have a guest in, but we also want to respect quarantine rules. So we're like, who do we love? But we also trust their quarantine. And you basically haven't left your house since you did this podcast 4 months ago, right?
Robert, I haven't showered since I saw you last.
I still love it.
We've been up all night filming. That's why we're late. We were filming till 4 a.m. This is why I have all these eyelashes in my hair and I'm all like.
What takes so long?
Hmm? Well,
what takes so long? We do an hour podcast in an hour.
Is your podcast an hour?
Yeah, we do an hour podcast. We record for an hour.
You don't have to
Bryce and Gabby
hour,
work until their hands bleed, and then we just go home and chill.
No, an hour is short. We go on forever.
But I'm saying
we talked, I remember, for a while.
Yeah, a long time. Yeah. And then they chopped up the episode in ways that I couldn't understand. So
were you talking about you were filming your podcast till 4 a.m? Or you're shooting?
No, we were shooting. We were actually filming.
What are you doing?
Okay, Ginger's directing.
This is so dope.
This is Ginger, our friend Ginger, who was a PA back in the day on The Sopranos.
She was on the last episode.
Oh, she was on this with us. Yes, she's sitting across from us right now.
Good for you.
And so Chicken, you guys know Chicken,
yes.
Who is the production coordinator on The Sopranos. He wrote a series of scripts for people in quarantine to film on their iPhones. And he's putting this whole series together. And he gave me one that was freaking awesome. And he was like, you know, Ginger, we'll just film it. We didn't realize it was going to turn into an epic production. Because we had to go back into the 1940s last night. Wow. We had a whole 1940s era bunch of scenes. It was insane.
How fun.
But I feel like you love to do. But you're doing are you the only actor in it?
Yes.
Wow.
I played a character who,
finally what you've been waiting for.
Who got trapped in her house in quarantine and the ghost of the previous tenant. Who was a big famous movie star, starts to try to take over her body. And it's hysterical. But more importantly, even though Chris wrote it, which is amazing, Chicken, Ginger's directing It's my new favorite thing.
Yeah.
Oh my God, it's my new favorite thing.
She says things that don't even exist. Like she like blames it on guys. You're like, we're the only two here. And she's like, no, it's the grip. It's his fault, right?
Every time we're in the kitchen, she's like, excuse me, don't talk to me. We're crafty right now.
Yeah.
No matter where we are, it refers to a film. You know, if Robbie's holding a light, can you get the grip? Can you get the gaffer or whatever it's been funny.
It's funny she tells you not to talk because all we did on the set of Sopranos was talk by Crafty. That was our Jamie was talking about when she took up smoking cigarettes for a year on Sopranos. She was like, "That I had new friends.
So many more friends.
Yeah.
I talked to so many people.
Crafty?
Well, the one year I smoked cigarettes filming Sopranos, everyone was, all of a sudden I'm like, this is where everybody is.
Smoking
I would always
cigarettes.
Like sit by myself eating like the dried strawberries at Crafty. Like, finally I had
picking
friends.
Out the green jelly beans while we're all just in the back
smoking
and spitting.
Section.
Yes.
When did you stop smoking cigarettes?
By the way, I hear interviews from back in the Soprano days and my voice, I'm talking like this. It's fucking crazy.
Really?
Well, because you were such a like rebel that everybody was like, yeah, I was Marlboro Reds and then some people Marlboro this, Marlboro that. And you would come out with like fucking Winston.
You remember.
Yeah, of course. Come on. Yes. I remember everything. I used to watch you through your window.
Winston Red. Yes, you did. Winston Reds.
Winston Reds.
Yeah.
The only chick I've ever, maybe the only person I've ever met who smoked Winston. I don't even know where she
who
bought
wasn't
them.
On a horse. Yeah.
Yeah. Where do you even find those? Did you have to get those shipped from
vintage
Texas?
Boxes in my attic from all the mafiosos in my family.
All right, so where do we see or when do we get to see the thing that you shot? When's that going
to
go up?
I don't know. Ginger has to have an editor's cut. And then we're going to put music to it. But Chicken is editing and doing everything. Yeah, and there's a bunch of different storylines. So they all come together through some Pilates instructor. Because everybody's quarantining with some Pilates instructor. I can't believe how creative this whole thing was that Chicken put together.
That's really cool.
Yeah, it was cool. So yeah, we've been filming nonstop. We've been filming my music videos for my boyfriend's record that's about to come out.
I'm shocked. Your boyfriend is a musician?
Isn't it fucking weird, dude?
Rob doesn't want you to talk about your boyfriend while you're here, if that's okay.
I didn't bring him, okay?
She's soothing me.
I didn't bring him.
This is a method. She soothes me when she's going to deliver some bad news. All right. You got a boyfriend. I can handle it. Did you guys quarantine together? This fucking lucky bastard.
He got stuck at the house. He was just visiting and then boom. Wow. Automatic.
Just like Ginger.
Yeah. We had a party during our quarantine, even though we were all nervous wrecks and having panic attacks the whole time.
What kind of party did you have?
No party. It was just all of us together. It was me, Ginger, Robbie, Monkey, Letty, the two kids. So we had a lot of people there, you know? So we were lucky in that respect for sure.
Yeah, that is nice.
How many?
I know you were by yourself, Robert.
I was. How many? Some nights you were there. How many tattoos do you have?
I don't know. Should we count?
Yeah. There we go. Oh, you'd have to remove a ton of clothing.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. Maybe.
And you have a tattoo 16. That says no lying, right? You have a tattoo. With
17. Yeah.
But don't you lie all the time?
I don't lie.
She does not lie.
I don't
You are
lie.
So full of shit. Tell them what happened. Tell them what happened with Conan.
Oh, yeah, I lied.
Yeah, okay, we'll get that one lasered off.
What happened?
Yeah.
Tell Jamie.
Oh. Okay.
Conan O'Brien.
Not the barbarian.
Yeah.
It was Conan. Yeah. It was the barbarian.
Yeah.
I was so nervous to do talk shows. But I don't know. Did you guys ever do talk shows when we were back?
Yes, the worst.
Yeah.
Okay, I had really.
Hey, Karen, just a drink.
I was so nervous to do them, but don't you fucking get me sick.
I know.
The corona.
Coronavirus. I bailed the day of my Conan interview, and my dog was sick. Ginger can attest to this. My dog really was sick. I just took it a little farther and said, he could have died that night because he could have died every night. He was dying, but I really just didn't want to go. I said that did I say the dog died?
Yep.
Oh, you stood up Conan. Like you didn't go to do your talk show night.
Told Conan, my dog died.
Did I say the dog died or that the dog was dying?
And then you went?
You said, no. Oh. She said the dog died, but
he
you
sent
know
me
what?
Flowers.
That's nice.
Yeah.
He sent flowers?
Well, you know, his team sent flowers.
We're so sorry for your loss. Hope you're okay. while she's like throwing the fucking ball and the dog's running catching the ball.
No, that wasn't happening.
Yeah,
that wasn't happening.
The dog was fine.
The dog was dying.
But then how do you have that tattoo and you try and pretend like you don't lie? You're full of shit.
It's more of a reminder.
Well, that was the tattoo came.
She looks
much
in the mirror. She's like, oh,
maybe
shit.
She got it right after.
But it was way after. It was my life had changed a lot. But it wasn't like I was incessantly lying about things. I was so scared to go on. If you'd ever see me on a talk show, you'd be like, this bitch should not be on a talk show, at all.
Could you imagine if Sopranos back in that day had social media?
No.
No.
How weird
no.
it would be. I've said it before, but like Tony Sirico, who played Paulie Walnuts, like on Snapchat or like no. something. You know what I mean? Yeah, on TikTok, like doing dances.
Who would have been really active, do you think, on social media?
I think you.
You,
I don't know.
You and I might have been bad about it.
Yeah, we might have. I wouldn't.
I get nervous
but still
on
to this
set,
day,
though.
I never bring it. I never
no, I
bring it
be.
On a set.
No, right. I don't either.
I'm not. I don't like flaunt my work. I like whore my kids out.
Yeah,
yeah. I
do
was doing
I mean?
That for a while
so
with the kids too, and then I started to get nervous about doing that.
But they're so cute.
I know.
It's fun to share that. It makes people happy. I think.
I agree. I love sharing the kids.
I know.
But I feel like Edie would never do it.
I think
Edie would have never.
I think this is you guys do it right because I've seen both your
well,
guys.
Mine are
Instagram.
Crazy. My stories are crazy. My kids.
You have
are
your
like,
kids.
Fuck you.
Yeah, you have your kids, but every once in a while you let them know. You remind everyone you're still hot.
Yep.
Your photo from the shoot. I think you were in like a bra or something. Last night.
Oh. She doesn't even remember last night.
No.
And then you, and then sometimes you do
yes,
it too. Not the bra, but like you dress up nice and you remind
Every
people
once
that.
Once in a while,
yeah.
I put clothes
I'll
on.
Show you where these kids came out of.
Yeah.
Wow.
Oh,
Manscaped.
You like my spread eagle shots that I do?
Yeah.
You got to look quick because they delete them really fast. Oh, I put them out just as a teaser.
You said you showed your belly the other week, right? On Instagram or something, you're telling me?
Well,
you hussy.
By accident.
Yeah, sure.
Like my t-shirt was up and Cutter was, is that what you mean when Cutter was like, you're very brave for putting it
isn't mommy brave, guys?
No, wait,
like, what?
I've seen some bikini shots of you up there and you smoking hot. You should
that was
be
pre-quarantine,
bikini.
But thank you.
Yeah, I know, I'm with you on that.
Drea.
Love
we love
you.
Nice sign
oh,
work.
I love
thanks,
you guys.
Drea. Thanks for
thanks
coming
for
back.
Thanks for getting me out
somewhere,
of the house.
Somewhere out there, Joe Perino is fucking pissed that you're the first three-time guest. But
who's that?
Sorry, Joe.
His friend that's been on it twice. Our friend.
Well, he's a
our friend.
He's an
our
incredible friend. Actor. He's not just my friend. He's you know he's a great friend
human.
Of ours. He's an amazing actor.
He had the corona.
He had corona.
He had corona?
Yeah, his credits are.
Did he talk into this mic? Because I don't.
Yeah.
No, that was before. That was
in New York.
Before
it's in New York.
Whole thing. Yeah.
Okay.
But thank you guys for listening. Ginger's yeah. here. We love Ginge so much.
Thanks for coming
I can't wait
back.
To. She's directing now.
Oh my God. Yeah. We're going to work on a movie together
Unstoppable.
Now. I have a screenplay. I have a play that we're going to adapt into a screenplay for her.
Fuck yeah.
That is insane about my life. My life story that she loves this story about Monkey. It's going to be really great. We're doing
Come
it.
On.
It's happening.
And by the way, next time you come back, we need to talk about how I saw a clip of you from a movie and you were talking to your vagina and you were calling it Betty.
Vagina monologues?
What was that,
You
Ginger?
Were in like a dressing room
was
and
I
you
asleep
like opened
for
your
this
panties
one?
And you were like, Betty, don't. You had only a bra and underwear on.
Of course you
Did
would
you
have
find that.
That
on that Hustler X thing? That what was it?
I might have.
X-Hamster?
It's research, guys.
Was it on X-Hamster?
Listen, I got notes. This is what I do, so... It might have been on Pornhub. Guys, thanks for
watching, guys. If you're watching on YouTube, hit subscribe and hit the notification bell, and that'll let you know when our videos come up. And follow us on Instagram and follow Drea on Twitter and Instagram, Drea DeMatteo, and Made Women is your podcast, and youtube.com/Made Women. And
thank you to Braddock and Manscaped.
And Manscaped and Braddock
oh, no.
USA.
No,
and
Level Press.
Braddock,
in
yeah,
my
level.
PJ Pants for Level Press and then PJ Pants for BraddockUSA.com.
And PJ Pants for Manscaped.
And this is Cassim saying, looks like you got some poopies in there. We'll
oh,
see you next time.
No.